Nou, ja, volgens mij werkt het, hè? Goed, gelukkig. Even wat gedoetjes, maar het werkt, uiteindelijk. Welkom iedereen, goedemiddag. Hopelijk lekker gegeten even. Oh, ups. Ik ben Kees. Je hebt een vraag, nu al?
Yes.
Oh, can we switch to English? Sure, of course. So also for you, I hope you had a good lunch. My name is Kees. I work for Xperit as an ALM / DevOps consultant. So I do a lot of stuff with VSTS as a tool. So today we'll go sort of a deep dive into how to build an extension from scratch. So a lot of code. I hope you don't mind. And what I'm bringing you is my learnings from working on a project with the Visual Studio ALM Rangers, where we built a ton of extensions. So you can reach me online, and if you want to have an explanation for the wall under my eyes, this is it. This is my little boy, now almost 3 months old. It's a lot of fun, but also a little bit tiring sometimes. But before we get started, I'd like to hear from you. Who has ever tried to build an extension for VSTS? Some people. Who actually got it working? Ah, so it's a little bit less already. Who thought at some point, what the am I doing? Yeah, it's good. To be honest, so there are it's very confusing. When I got started, there were so many frameworks, so many tools, so many things, and not a real easy way to get started. And what it often boils down to is a little comic that I found about setting up your programming environment. That's typically something nobody understands, but you have to do it. So today I'd like to walk you through one of the ways of doing that for a VSTS extension. It's certainly not the only way, but it's a way that I found very convenient and at least works. But to start with the basics, what exactly is a UI extension for VSTS? Well, basically it's what the word says. So it's a way to extend the user interface with added functionality. And that can be in many places. So you can build, for example, a dashboard widget to show build status or something else. You can have additions to the work item form, for example, an extra page there with some stuff that you want to show. You can even go much higher in the level and add hubs or groups, or add things like actions in context menus. So these are the things that you can think about when you want to enrich the user interface of VSTS. Now, if you want to build such a thing, what do you need? What do you need to make? So what's in such an extension? Well, a few things. It starts with a manifest, which is basically a JSON file that contains some basic info. So there is, for example, your name would be in there. So things like what's the name of the extension, what's a little bit of metadata. And that also contains pointers to the actual code, so that VSTS knows which code to call when your extension needs to be included. And a good thing to know is that you can split this manifest into different parts. So for example, you can have a generic part and specific parts, for example, for test and production or something like that. Next thing that you need is a bit of discovery assets. So basically, I call that the marketplace stuff. So that's all the marketing, screenshots, documentation, links to your GitHub repo, stuff like that. And then the actual bread and butter of the thing. So that's the code that gets called whenever your extension needs to be invoked. And that the important thing is that that needs to be static. So it can be HTML or images or JavaScript, but not PHP files, for example, or ASP.NET stuff. Now, when you take all that stuff together, you stuff it in a VSAX file, and then you upload it to the Visual Studio Marketplace, which is the way of distributing your extension to people that you want to show it to. So that can be people you select. It can also be public. We'll see that in a little bit. Now, I've shown you a couple of examples of what a UI extension can be. But how do you determine what it will be? And that's when we get to the point that we need to talk about contributions. So a contribution is basically your contribution to VSTS. But you need to decide where your extension will show up. VSTS has a bunch of extension points for that that you can hook up to. So first thing that you need to do is find the extension point where you want your extension to live and figure out what is the contribution type that needs to live there. And when you've done that, you can create your contribution, which is basically an instance of that contribution type, which targets that specific extension point. You can even go one step further and design your contribution as a extension point that other contributions can target. So this is when it gets sort of inception-like, but you get the idea. So you would have another contribution of another type that targets your own contribution. An example of this, to make it a little bit more more lively, is for example, in the top level menu of VSTS, you have what they call hub groups. So that's an extension point. You can add stuff there. So the to the hub group collection, and you can define, for example, your own hub group, which is of type ms.vss web hub group, and under that hub group you can have your own custom hubs. I'll show you this in real life in a little bit, but you need to know that these things are needed. Okay, so how does it actually work? I have an example here, very simple one, but we need to start simple, right? Which is a tab on the work item form, which just shows a simple hello world. Easy enough, right? Basically, what this thing is, it's just a web page, which is loaded in an iframe. That iframe has content, which in this case is a simple HTML page, which shows a hello world. But just like any other web page, it needs to be loaded from a web server. That web server can be any web server you want. So in very simple cases, you can have Microsoft host your extension content for you on VSTS itself. But if you have more complex cases where you, for example, want to do server-side processing, I don't know what, then you can create your own web server or maybe in Azure or somewhere, doesn't really matter, and host the content of your extension there. And in the manifest file, you point to the location of that web server so that VSTS knows where to get the stuff. Now, since it's just a web page, you can do whatever you want from there. So you can call external services, databases, web APIs, whatever you want. So these things can get very complex, but also very rich. And Microsoft provides the VSTS client SDK, which is a big JavaScript file that handles communication to VSTS itself for you. So you don't have to worry about authentication. And it will also give you, for example, an easy way to call VSTS APIs to get information from the system, and also a bunch of controls for and stuff like that, so that you can make your extension look like it's actually part of VSTS. All right, so this is all good. But you can imagine when you're developing such a thing, and you have to package all the stuff that, that you've written into a VSIX, upload it to VSTS, load it up, and then see that it doesn't work. So how do you debug such a thing? Basically, this is where we started thinking, how can we do this? And we came up with a little trick, me together with some guys from the ALM Rangers, where we were working on this project. And what we did has to do with this guy, the web server. So what I told you is that the content is always loaded from a web server, and it can be any web server. So what if I replace that web server with my own laptop? And I run a web server on there, just locally. And I make a specific manifest for my development environment where I tell VSTS to load the contents of that iframe from localhost instead of some web server somewhere. Then I can use Chrome to just open up VSTS. And why I like to use Chrome is because it has a nice debugger. And I can connect to that debugger from my code editor, which is Visual Studio Code. And then I have a pretty good experience because I can just set breakpoints and it will hit and everything will work. Even the web server that we're using, it's pretty smart. So when we're inside the code editor and we're writing code and we hit save, the web server will detect it and it will reload automatically. So we don't have to upload stuff or whatever. And this makes for a very quick development cycle. And what I want to do is show you how to build this from scratch. So let's write some code, right? Unfortunately, no. We need some tools. Like always, we need some tools. So like I told you, we're using Visual Studio Code as an editor to write all this stuff. It's all JavaScript. More specifically, it's all Node.js based. So we're using Node.js, and we'll use the Node Package Manager, which is NPM, as sort of an entry point for a lot of stuff. I'll show you in a bit. Like I told you, we need Chrome, and we need the Chrome debugger, which connects to VS Code. And allows us to actually do the debugging. Once we have all that, we can really start coding. Okay, so let's do that. Let me switch my screen so that I can see what I'm doing. Okay, so what would be the first thing to do whenever we start a new project? You as software developers, what do? First thing. Come on. That sounds good, but well, actually what I was aiming at is you create a Git repo, of course, right? First thing you do. So I did that. My Git repo is right here. It's called a long name. this is actually up on GitHub, so I have the link at the end of my presentation, so you can take a look at the code yourself. And when I look in what's actually inside this repository, the basic structure that you need is something like this. So it's a Git repo, so I've created a Git ignore file. Actually, when you're working with extensions like this and compiling stuff, you get a lot of files that you don't need in your repository. And since we're using Node, we have the, for example, the Node modules directory, which is downloaded from the internet. Well, we don't need to check it in. Things like that. And what you'll see here is we have a couple of directories with just some basic stuff. So we have img for images. We have libs for libraries. Here we have the manifest config directory that contains the specific configurations of that manifest. So in this case, because I'm just getting started, I only have one for dev. My marketplace discovery stuff, this node modules directory, and in our source directory we have the actual code of the extension. You do create directory, and then you create one. But basically, what the structure here is sort of arbitrary. It's just something that we found convenient for ordering our stuff. But yeah, it's not mandatory or something at all. Sorry, what that? I just created a bunch of folders.
Just by hand.
Yeah. No, that's the whole thing. There's no such thing as a template. So that's why we, this effort is to sort of create a template like that. So I have this in a Git repo now, but it doesn't have any functionality in it except for the hello world part. So whenever we start a new extension, we just use that Git repo as a starting point.
So from now on, we can use your GitHub repo as our starting point?
If you want, yeah, sure. Go for it. Like I said, the contents of a UI extension needs to be static files. So typically, whenever you want to do dynamic stuff on the web, you'd use JavaScript. I don't know about you, but I don't like JavaScript so much. I'm more of a strongly typed guy. So what we're doing is we're using TypeScript, which is sort of like strongly typed JavaScript, which helps a lot. Gives you, for example, nice IntelliSense inside your editor and catches a lot of mistakes at compile time, because you do need to compile your TypeScript into JavaScript files. So I'll show you a bit of TypeScript later, but if you want to use TypeScript, you need sort of a configuration file to tell the compiler how to translate that TypeScript into JavaScript. So this is an initial file. There's a simple command to create it. It's called TSC for the TypeScript compiler, --- init, and it'll give you this. So I won't go through it. It's just the default thing. We have the Node Package Manager, so we need that to pull in all our dependencies. But we also use it as sort of a script runner. The configuration file for npm is this thing, the package.json. So what you'll see, it contains the dependencies. So for example, we're using Q, which is a library, and we're also using this. This is actually the VSTS client SDK with a specific version. So that's all good. And the other thing that's interesting in here is a bunch of scripts that we have defined here. And I'll show you later how to actually use these things. So these are actions, sort of, that we perform from the command line to, for example, start up our development web server or compile our sources into a VSAX package that we can upload. This is a very convenient way to script those commands into, you know, basically sort of a shorter command. Okay, so the thing that we'll use to start up our development web server is this thing. So it's a script called dev. We can call it by typing npm run dev, easy as that. And what it will do it'll start up the Webpack dev server. Webpack is the tool that we're using to compile our TypeScript into JavaScript, gather all our assets that we need, so CSS files and image files and all that stuff, and put it all together in a directory that we can then package into a VSIX file. But since it's a web server, we need a configuration file for it, which is this thing, webpack.config. Also very basic configuration file, so I'm not going to go through it in all detail. What's interesting is it needs an entry point, so which TypeScript file is the entry point for our application, which is this app.ts, and that will be compiled into an app.js. And what Webpack will do is whenever we include other TypeScript files or modules or stuff in this app.ts, it will automatically pull them in, and everything will get compiled into this big app.js file. So we don't need to worry about that. The other thing that's interesting here is that our dev server will run on HTTPS instead of HTTP. VSTS has the requirement that content that gets loaded for an extension needs to be on a secure web server. If you run it on an HTTP server somewhere, you will get a nice red error bar saying extension blah 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 by, so it will have your name there, failed to load. And that's of course something that you don't want your users to see. So make sure it's on HTTPS. Okay, so that's basically all the plumbing that we need. Just one more thing, we need something to show to the user. And that will be, in my case, a sample page HTML file, which doesn't really contain much. But what it does contain are two functions from the VSTS client SDK that get called whenever this page is loaded. And these two things, they set up the communication from our extension to VSTS. So first we do some initialization. The most interesting things here are these two. So use platform scripts true. That allows us to use, for example, the controls that Microsoft has defined. So you can get a button or a grid that has the design of all the other buttons and grids inside VSTS, and you can use it in your extension. And same goes for the styles, but those are styles like, for example, headers or paragraphs, things like that. A little bit more interesting is this thing, VSS.ready, that gets called whenever VSTS is ready to load your extension. And what it'll do, it will load from source slash app, which is this thing, source slash app. It will load that up and then call the register method on that app. This little trick require, that is a sort of a way to include TypeScript files, but it's a little bit smarter than just including them, because require will make sure that this file only gets loaded so whenever it's needed. So if you don't need it, it's not going to be loaded, so it's not going to be pulled across the line. So this is a little bit helping in giving your users a nice experience in terms of performance. You can imagine if you have a very big extension with lots of files to load up, and you load them all at the beginning, then it takes a very long time for the VSTS web page to come up, which is not so nice. So this makes sure it only gets loaded when it's needed. And so then we call the app.register. I'll show you that method in a bit. And whenever that's finished, we have to tell VSTS that our extension loaded successfully, so that we don't get that red error bar. All right, so let's look at our app. which is in TypeScript. What I have here, this extension will give you a page on the work item form. And whenever this this extension is loaded, we'll call the register method. And what that will do, it'll call again the register method from the VSTS client SDK and register a work item notification listener on our contribution. And this is where TypeScript becomes very handy, because this is this thing, a work item notification listener, it's strongly typed, so it's defined. So we know what to put in there. And in this case, it's for methods that get called whenever specific events on the work item form happen. So for example, when it's loaded, something will happen. When it's unloaded, something will happen. When the user refreshes it, and when it's saved. The last three, we don't do anything for now. But whenever the form is loaded, we'll call a method writeOutput, which is below here. And that will just write a simple hello world. So it seems like a lot of code, and actually it is, a lot of configuration files to just do the hello world. But once you have all this in place, then of course you can expand this hello world into whatever your imagination can come up with and make some cool things. OK, so how do we run this thing? Well, I have to go to my command line. And first thing that I need to do is run npm install, which will pull all the dependencies that I've defined in my package.json. So for in this case, it's only the VSTS client SDK Q library. And it will pull them from the internet and put them in my in the proper directories. So that takes a little bit. Depends on your Wi-Fi connection. Yesterday I was doing this in the train. Then it takes a little bit longer. And now, once this is done, I can do npm run dev. And if you remember correctly, this will start up that Webpack dev server. And that will look in the Webpack configuration file, figure out which files it needs to compile, and do that. And then it'll serve up our stuff. So compiled successfully, that's good. And you can actually see that this thing is running on HTTPS. And I defined port 1990 in this case. And this is our extension. Of course, it's not really doing anything yet. But you can see we have here the same, all these same directories in here. And I can load that sample page. But as you remembered, in that sample page, the only thing it does is calls VSTS to tell that the extension is ready. So well, in this case, I have no VSTS, so nothing is happening. So that's actually the next step. So what we need to do now is integrate this thing with VSTS. So what I need to do is I need to create a VSAX package that I can upload to the marketplace and install in my VSTS account. And that VSAX package needs to contain a manifest that points to my local web server. So let's do that. I'm not going to write it all now. So what I've done is in my Git repo, I have a couple of branches that sort of incrementally go through this process. So what I'm going to do is switch to my VSTS integration branch, and that has those things already in place. So what I can show you now is I have this VSS extension.json. This is actually the manifest file. So what you can see here, it has a bunch of metadata. My extension needs to have an ID, a version number, a name. We need to tell VSTS in which area our extension operates, so that we don't get to do unauthorized stuff. Description, blah, 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 blah. So this is pretty self-explanatory, I think. What is interesting is the contribution part here. So this is why I needed to walk you through that contribution and contribution types bit. In this case, my extension has only a single contribution. You can actually have more than one. My contribution needs to have an ID, so it will be the sample work item page. And here is the contribution type. Like I told you, we're going to build a Hello World page on the work item form. So makes sense for our contribution to have a type of work item form page, because that's what it is. And it targets, and this is the extension point that is defined in VSTS itself. Each contribution type has a specific set of properties. And in the case of a work item form page, it's just a name and where to find the page to load. That's it. If you want to figure out which extension points exist, that can be a tricky task. Actually, there is an extension for that. What we at the ALM Rangers did is we created an extension that has a contribution for each and every extension point that exists in VSTS. So it has a huge manifest, and what it will do is if you install that extension, you will get a little yellow star everywhere that where you can contribute to the UI. So if you want to figure out which contribution target and type is with that, you need to go into the manifest. It's on GitHub, and there you can find it. All right. So this is the common part of the manifest. I also have a little dev part here that I'm gonna merge with that common part. And here you see the magic where we point VSTS to our localhost. And the other thing that I need to do is give my extension a different name, because names need to be unique. So if I have an extension with a name, I cannot have another one with the same name. And so I'm calling it dev so that I can have another version for test and another one for prod. All right. So last thing, we need to figure this out and merge it all together. So we have a little script for that. That's this script, in which we call tfx, which is the command line utility for building and managing extensions. And there we load this dev JSON and merge it with VSS extension JSON. And the output will be called something dash dev, so that we know that this is the dev version. All right, so let's build this thing. Actually, that TFX is a tool which we get from NPM. So I need to run NPM install again, and it will download the required tools. And once that finishes, I can run NPM run publish dev, which is again a script that I defined in my package JSON, publish dev, and that will run that script that I just showed you. So if I do that, it has created the package. And lo and behold, it's right there. So this is my my VSIX. And if I want to show that inside VSTS, because that's my goal, I need to upload it to the marketplace. So marketplace.visualstudio.com. And here, this little button, publish extensions, that gets you to the publisher portal, where you can upload new extensions. So I have a bunch of them already here, but I'm gonna upload the one that I just created. Oop, I love drag and drop. Upload. Well, there's a little bit of a verification process in here. So they're gonna check for malicious content and stuff like that. Luckily, my extension is very simple, so that's very quick. And what you can see here, once you upload something, it'll be private by default. So only visible for you, not shared with any accounts. So I'm going to share it with, in this case, my own. Up. And then I can install it there. So it's, there's always the sharing an extension, and then you need to install it to actually stick it in that account. You get lots of notifications. Up, install. So, okay. Now I have my extension installed, but as you remembered, it's pointing to localhost. So if I want this to work, I need to run my web server again. So let's do that. npm run dev. We did this before, right? So it'll start up. And then I can go into my VSTS account and hopefully show you that we have an extra page on the work item form. So just any work item, and actually the page is there, and lo and behold, it's showing Hello World. So this is actually now served from my laptop right here. Well, this opens up some opportunities because we're almost there. Only thing left to do is connect this Chrome debugger to VS Code. And then I'll be happy on my way with my my local development lifecycle. Unfortunately, we need some more configuration files. I have these in another branch, which I'm going to check out. Oop. And I'll show you, it's not too bad actually. For VS Code, there's this launch.json, and that defines launch configurations for the debugger in VS Code. And a launch configuration has a specific type, and in this case, it's Chrome, and that tells VS Code to use the Chrome debugger in this case. So it'll launch Chrome, and it'll launch a specific URL. And what I've done is I've defined a specific user data directory so that Chrome is running in sort of a sandbox, which helps with caching and all that stuff that you usually don't want when doing development. Okay, so this should work, right? I'm going to kill this one. I need to run my web server again. There we go. And then I can go here. And VS Code has a debug tab. And you'll see this list where it shows all the configurations that are defined in this launch.json. And you can even add configurations. And it has a bunch of templates that you can use. So you can also do PowerShell or I don't know, Mago, I've never heard of it, but .NET, .NET Core, whatever you want. For now, we'll stick to this and just start debugging the thing. What you'll see, it'll open up VSTS with the URL that I specified. And now I can open up a work item, go to this page, Hello World. That's good. But this is debugging mode. So we should do some debugging, right? So let's go back to our editor. Go in here. Go to app. And maybe set the breakpoint. Now, if I go here and I open this work item again, boom. What you'll see here is you'll get a paused in Visual Studio Code thingy. And it'll start flashing below here, and you'll see it actually hit the breakpoint. So that's pretty cool. And I can just step through there and do all the things that I'm used to when debugging. when I go into the debugging window, you'll see you can define watches, you can hover, stuff like that. It all just works, and you can jump in and over methods and all that, just like you're used to. And when I'm done here, I can just hit continue and it all load. Fun thing is that because now we're running our web server locally, and like I told you, it's watching the files that it has loaded. So what I can do, without stopping debugging mode or anything, I can just maybe change my code a little bit, save it, and then what should happen is whenever I open it back up here, it'll hit the breakpoint again, continue, and it changed. So this is a very short development cycle. I admit it takes a bit of setting up, but once you have this in place, then you're good to go. All right, so now let's say we're done developing. We need to release this thing. Well, then of course it's not very handy if my code is hosted on my laptop. because that's not always on, and it'll be very far away, and so not very good. So we need to package our extension into a VSIX that contains all the stuff that we need for running our application. We can do that, but again, we need some more configuration. Luckily, that has been done. Okay, so for actually doing the release, I'm going to stop debugging mode, is we've done a couple of things. So what you'll see here, we have created that release JSON. So that's the file that gets merged into the manifest, but then for the release version of our extension. Basically, it's very simple. It tells VSTS that or at least the marketplace, that our extension, in this case, is not public. Normally, when you want to make an extension available to the world, you would set public to true. However, you need to be a verified publisher on the marketplace in order to do that. So there's a little bit of a process. You have to tell Microsoft, hey, I want to publish extensions that are available to the entire world. And they verify you by asking you a bunch of questions, and then you get a little check marks by your name, and then you will be able to publish public extensions. In my case, I'm not, so I cannot do that. So I have to put this as false. The rest of it is all in the common manifest, which I haven't changed. Okay, so. The other thing that's interesting is that also the webpack configuration file has been split into a common and a dev and release bit, where in the dev bit, the only thing that's remaining is the configuration for that development server. For release, we don't need that because we're not going to be running our web server. What we do need, however, is to tell webpack where to put all the files. So that's this little bit. So it'll copy files into a specific directory path. And the other thing that we've done, and this is a node specific configuration, is tell node by setting an environment variable that it's actually running in production. So it'll do a bunch of optimizations. And then the only thing we need is a script to stick it all together. So we already had the package dev script. We also have a package release script, which basically is pretty much the same as the package dev. So it will run tfx, create that extension, but in this case it will use the release JSON and merge it with the common configuration manifest and output that file. So that's it. in our npm file, again, some more lines to actually fire these scripts. So I can do that. I can create our release package here. I can do npm run package release. Boom. Ah. So for merging webpack configuration files, I'm using an npm module, which is called webpack merge, which I haven't installed in this case. So I need to do an npm install. Hop, hop, hop. And then run the same thing again. Oh, okay, this is a good one. You saw me dragging and dropping my dev VSIX file into the browser to upload it to the marketplace. There's a strange bug in Edge, the browser that I used, that locks files forever if you drag and drop them. My package release script tries to remove all VSIX files, including my dev one, and it cannot do it because Edge has it locked. This caused me quite a bit of headache before. But what I need to do is just close Edge. And now run this thing again. This is these are the things that keep you awake at night. And what you'll see, again, Webpack will be run. It'll compile all the stuff that we need. But for now, it won't start the dev server, but it'll create my VSIX file. And I can show you, it's right here. And actually, it's just a sort of a zip file. So I can look inside and see that all my stuff is there. So it has that manifest, but now it's sort of translated into a version that the marketplace understands. And we have all our files that we told it to put there. For example, our sources, so that sample page that gets loaded, and in this case, our app.js. So that's our compiled TypeScript code, which gets put in here. I could upload this thing to the marketplace, but hey, we're decent software developers, so we're not going to publish release versions that we built on our own laptop. We need a proper build and release pipeline for that, right? So that's also there. I'd like to show you that. I have it in VSTS. Yeah? So we're building extensions for VSTS with VSTS, so that's kind of interesting. So first thing, let me trigger a build. That takes a while, so we'll look at the result after I walk you through what's actually happening. So first thing that we do is we run a build, and that will create our VSIX package. And basically what we do here is pretty much the same steps that we do that we did locally. So we run an npm install, we run an npm build release. That will create our folder structure that we can then package into our VSIX. Only difference is that we're using a VSTS task to create that VSIX instead of using the TFX command line utility. The reason why we do that is because this task allows me to override a bunch of settings for that VSIX. For example, the version. So what I want to do is set the version number of my extension to the build number that I ran here. These tasks, so these extension tasks here, these are also part of an extension, which are the CI/CD tools for VSTS extensions. I have a link later on in the slide. So if you want to build and release pipelines for extensions, then that's a very, very useful one. So this will create a VSAX package, and of course then we store it. Once that package is created, we want to, of course, release it. And releasing it, in this case, means setting it, putting it in the marketplace. So in this case, I had the dev version in the marketplace. That was for my local development, so I don't have that in my release pipeline. In my release pipeline, I only have test and production. So in test, whenever I want to deploy to test, which is maybe sort of a private group of testers that you want to show your extension to, only thing that you need to do is publish that VSAX to your marketplace publisher. So so we take that VSAX file from the build, and then again, we can use this task to override a bunch of properties on that VSAX. We need to give it a unique ID because this is the test version, and we can have IDs in the marketplace need to be unique, as well as give it a name which includes test so that we can recognize it. Otherwise, we have a bunch of extensions, so a dev version, a test version, and a production version, all with the same name in the marketplace, which makes it hard to distinguish one from another. And we can set, for example, the visibility to only private preview. So that means that only select people will be able to see it. And you can even define here with which accounts do you want to share your extension in this phase of the development. So that could be you and a couple of selected beta testers or something like that. That's basically it. That will deploy it to the marketplace. And then last thing is stick it to production. It's basically the same thing, except that you could, of course, put different settings here. So share it with people, set the name to the proper name. So we don't need to override the ID anymore, because now then it will just use the ID that's in the manifest file, and set your visibility to public, which I'm not allowed to do because I'm not a verified publisher. Now, what should have happened is I ran that build. That build will trigger a release. We can see that it has happened in test. For production, it's still waiting on my approval. Let's just go wild and approve it. So it'll run, and let's see what happens. So I can go into my publisher page again, which I just had to close. And what you can see here, the dev version I just uploaded, but now there's also a test version here, which has the version number from the build. And currently it's deploying to prod as well. So hopefully, yeah, it's right there. So then it loses the test label. So this is the way to get your stuff into the marketplace. And then we're in production, right? So finished. Only thing left for me to do is send you off with some tips. So in here I have the summary, so I'll just skip through that. So what we did is we used a whole bunch of tools. So we've written our extension in TypeScript. We used Webpack to stick everything together. We used NPM as a package manager and as a script runner. We used Chrome as a web browser and VS Code together for debugging, and then VSTS for creating a DevOps pipeline. So whenever you start with this stuff, a couple of tips. Read up on documentation. Well, that's a no-brainer, right? There's also a bunch of samples up on GitHub. Very useful. It's quite an extensive list. So you can learn a lot from there. But whenever you start working on this, performance is always an issue. So I showed you the require bit. That's actually very important. So use that instead of including all your scripts in the head file of your HTML, where they get loaded on startup, which is slow. And only use those platform scripts and platform styles when you need them, because that will also pull in a lot of code. And well, as a developer, use the Google. That also has a lot of stuff on there. Couple of pointers. So the contributions guide, that's the extension that I told you about that has a little yellow asterisk on all the contribution points that are there. The CI/CD tools for VSTS extensions, those are the build and release tasks that I used in my build and release pipeline. If you want to build bigger extensions, then you'll figure out that you need user controls. So there's a bunch of them in the VSTS client SDK, but not all of them. Office UI Fabric is a library with a lot of controls that all have the same look and feel as VSTS does. And you can include that, and it's for free, but it takes a little bit of getting used to. So there's a blog post here that explains how to do it. And whenever you want to get information from VSTS, because obviously you want to show stuff, so probably you'll need to call some APIs to do that. This is some documentation on those APIs. Actually, in my GitHub repo, there is another branch. So in my demos now, I showed you up until releasing the package. There's actually a fourth branch that has a sample of how to call one of these APIs. So, but I'll leave that up to you to look at it. So that was it. This is the URL where you can find the code that I just showed you. And I think the slides will be shared. Otherwise, take a picture and be sure to have it. So thank you.